Let's see. Grunge.
Yeah, I like the intro of this song. It's so good.
Wonderful, yeah. Hey, so Justin, Eric, Thorsten, David, Andreas, Manfred, Michael, Sava. Yeah, wonderful song. But we have to be a little bit careful today because those quite famous grunge songs, I can imagine they will hunt us to the Antarctic if we make one mistake. Mojo, hello, Mario, JBL, Elvis, Jeremy. Stanti, guten Abend. Thomas, guten Abend. Guten Abend, Gallery. Yeah, tonight it's grunge. Thomas.
Grunge and family.
Grunge and family, okay. Thomas, how is your approach on grunge as a collector, as a DJ? How is your approach? What is your personal opinion about this time and the music?
I think I started to listen to grunge when it was over, like in 1990, just before like the big boom came, just after. So I think I started with Nirvana and Soundgarden and Smashing Pumpkins, but I think it started already in the 80s. But for me, it started in the 90s, and I tried to collect like the most famous albums. I'm not so deep into 7 inches and stuff like that.
But before we
they're very collectible today. So,
yeah. Before we go to Stanti and his approach, I tell my only approach of it, because that's probably quite faster. At that time, I get into a techno club. And the audience was very strict with the music. One wrong song and they were furious. They booed DJs. It was terrible, terrible audience in a way. But in that crowd, one song, and that was when it came out, was quite popular. And that was Nirvana's Teen Spirit. They loved it. So grunge always also found its place at a lot of groups. It was not so narrow in my opinion. Stanti, your approach on grunge.
It's funny, your story is funny to me because Laurent Garnier, one of the biggest techno DJs of the early 90s, yeah, he used to play Smells Like Teen Spirit in almost every set he had, at the Rex Club, where he had the residency, one of the foremost clubs in Europe at the time, that still exists, by the way. It's probably the oldest techno club in Europe. But, well, for me, it's quite easy, like collecting it. I don't really collect it because I was there and I was the right age. So I bought it back then. The few things that I bought on CD or that I missed that I discovered later, I'm buying originals because that's the music of my youth. So, like, I don't care for any fancy box set with outtakes or all that. That's the music that is the most, the most instinctive to me. There's nothing, I don't want to be an archivist of that kind of music, to have the versions and all of that. So because basically the very first gig I went to was in January 1990, and it was a grunge. It was Tad, Nirvana, and a French band.
Yeah.
And we had no idea. We were completely taken by surprise. So for me...
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Same here. This music took us totally by surprise. I haven't heard it coming. Nothing at all. And I think at that time, at that club, everybody feels the same. But we all loved this song. We did.
The thing that was why was a teenager back then before never, okay, so before it Smells Like Teen Spirit, before grunge ever had a hit, why would you go all in into that music? Well, that's because of heavy metal that was ruling like the schoolyard and all of that, like this rock music that became corporate while trying to pretend it was rebellious. And you had these guys who didn't care about how they looked like. They didn't care if they were popular or not, or at least there was this ethos behind it, which was very appealing coming out of the extreme of like, you know, like, you know how the bands looked like in the 80s. So it was kind of a correction.
Yes.
Correction. What was labeled by the magazine as grunge, which was basically a mishmash of noise rock, lo-fi, indie rock, punk rock.
I just compared in my head Kurt Cobain and the guy from Kajagoogoo.
The guy from?
Kajagoogoo.
I don't know what you're talking
about. You don't know Kajagoogoo?
No.
Was his name Limahl?
Limahl, exactly. Stunt, you didn't know him. You don't? That's brilliant. That's brilliant. Have you prepared a song for us too, Stunt?
And one thing is that also most people obviously identify grunge with Seattle. But for me, grunge is as much New York, Austin in Texas, and the whole, Oregon, Washington. So here is, oh wait, yeah, I have to do my little.
Never only, of course.
There we go.
Here we go.
Can you hear it?
Insane. Very nice cover art, by the way. Very subtle. Why did you choose this one for the start of it?
So, I mean, this was a huge, huge, huge record back then in the underground. Of course, it didn't get any mainstream success, but the music is amazing. This is one of these bands that were touring all the time. I saw them 8 times live in Paris back then. So you would get them, and I also chose that one because there's a little bit of a thing between us with this record, Michael, since I bought this on CD when it was released.
Yeah.
And finally I got my original with you at Den Bosch a year and a half ago.
See? Meeting we wasn't only a bad thing.
And yeah, the Unsane were from New York, coming from noise, like very much into a non-star thing. Like their first drummer died of an overdose, which is kind of an ongoing theme in grunge, drug abuse, but not in a, you know, cocaine. No, it was not that kind of drugs, unfortunately, or who knows. But they had a few. I think they kind of still exist because they are a cult band. But back then, you'd go to a gig of them in Paris, that would be like 150 people, which was how the scene was. And
they would get probably 200 now, right?
No, now they would get like 500. Like it's
I was kidding. I was kidding.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Thomas, you are aware of Unsane?
I need that record. I can always feel it.
Yeah.
When you see it, you want it. Right. This is one of those records. And Stunty has shown this for quite some time, but I forgot about it, and now I want it again. Yeah.
The thing with Unsane, let me show. Yeah. So the Brooklyn Bridge, of course, there's this very, this, you know, 42nd Street feeling, like the street, like the this very seedy street in New York, where you had all the porn theaters and hustling and drugs. So they're very much about the seedy side of New York. And there's something, yeah, something very cinematographic about the music as well. Like, when you hear that, like, you instantly get these images of something sexy, but also scary and disgusting, which is, yeah, well, appealing to me when I was 13 or 14 for some reason.
Give us a little bit more of the music before we fade out of Unsafe. Quite some are very connected to grunge in the gallery this evening, which is not a surprise.
It's cool.
Yeah, that's cool. Grunge was a perfect antidote to 1980s hair metal scene. Yeah, of course, I totally get that.
I remember when this was released. I saw them live for the tour of that, which was 93 or 94. And I, of course, I bought a t-shirt, and the t-shirt was white with this as like a, you know, 16:9, like a white screen. And up until recently, I still had it. But it's always like when you put that t-shirt out, like, thank God it's like a band t-shirt and not just the image. Like, why would you have that otherwise? So yeah, there was a little bit of, it's funny how, like, most metal, the provocation was with demons, Satanism, and all of that. With grunge and noise rock, it's more about, like, the danger of real life.
Yeah, we need a little rock revival today. I agree on that part. That's true. New sounds and old. Thomas, you have prepared a record for us too?
Yes, I have two ready. You get one of them.
More careful than usual. And by the way, Mojo, he wants your t-shirt. It's,
no, unfortunately, it was not XXL. And just quickly, we forgot to show the first record that Thomas was playing.
Yeah. No, we did. Didn't we?
No, we didn't. Didn't. Show
oh, no, right, because we went so fast out of it. Yeah.
Yeah. The Wonderful. Second Smashing Pumpkins album, Science. Which I think is... the last grunge album they did. It has a couple of good songs, but really, for me, as you can see on the Thomas wall, I think he has it somewhere.
Yeah, it's on the wall.
The first album that was actually originally only released in Europe, if I remember correctly. And yeah, that one is... the production is much more grunge, and all the songs are more like hits in a way. They're more immediate than anything they did after, I think.
So, in other words, your favorite Smashing Pumpkins. I love Melancholy, yeah. Wow.
Yeah, but that's Peter... no, it's an... Oh! Yeah, it's a prog album.
Wait.
I think this is a solo product.
Okay. Well, I think, can you label them completely under grunge? Not completely, right? But at least the early stuff, you can.
The first two albums Yeah, after that, no, no. Then it's alternative rock.
Yeah.
That has some prog elements and even some. For me, like Melon Collin, it's almost like a Phil Collins album, if I'm being honest.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, see, new sounds and all the. Has it good, right?
It's still. Adore is a great album to have, in my opinion. Go, hey, Phil Collins. Yeah. So, Stunty.
You have to be entertaining a little bit. And
Of course, hey, Stunty, that was amazing. And I can imagine that Phil Collins is quite flattered. That you
yeah, because also to. I believe what I said. But...
The second album you prepared, Thomas, you said you had prepared two songs.
Yeah, but first, this one is the one we're playing now. So.
The amazing jacket, right? Alice in Chains.
They did some amazing albums.
Yes. This one is that. Yeah. And they are so hard to get. I mean, this goes for so many grunge records, which is probably due also to the time, right? That this is 90s. Vinyl was not that popular, to say the least. And so those originals are really, really, really difficult to get. And Stunty, what do you say to the quality of the first pressing in that time?
Well, most of the for me it's great, but I would say that kind of music is so. It's about the rawness is kind of important. Like often, there are a few albums that were released that the artist regretted to release it after they had a producer on it. And they thought, like, there's a lot of albums of grunge that have been destroyed by having a producer, basically.
Can you give us an example?
Not necessarily anything you would know, but...
Thank you.
No, but anyone. Like, there's this band called Mint 400, which is the name of the race in Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. They have three EPs, I'll show them maybe, that are absolutely amazing. And when they did the album, it sounds like shit, and it's exactly the same songs.
Okay.
Because they lost the rawness. And so I would say that like a good grunge record must have really great catchy melodies. Unlike it operates in a very different way than heavy metal.
Yeah.
So who like the sound quality like is not as important in a way, in the sense that like the music has to take you or to catch you like almost like a you know a very melodic punk song from 77. Like do you really care about having the best sound on a 45 of Anarchy in the UK? I don't. Of course, if it's dog shit quality, that's another problem. But what is your experience, Thomas? Because in my experience, I would say that like there's often a misconception about like vinyl records in the 90s sounding like shit. You could also argue that in the 90s, the people who press the records, they already have 40 years of experience. So they should be better at it than they were like 20 years before. Because yeah. It was still the entail. It was before people who knew what they were doing retired. You still had the people who knew what they were doing. So I honestly have no issues with 90s pressing.
So far, from what I've heard, I totally agree. There's one problem, in my opinion, that parallel we had the CD. The CD had a significantly longer playing time.
Yeah.
And in many cases, they put too much music on one kind on one side of the record. If you can say something bad about this period, I think it's that they often should have done a double album and they put it on one album.
That's true. Then again, most records from the 90s that are guilty of that are more coming from electronic music and hip hop, as rock records tend to have like still like around 10, 12 songs, and most songs are like 3 minutes long. Some are a little shorter. So, yeah, it's kind of true, but because of the intrinsic aesthetic quality of the music, you don't get, I think, to the breaking point where it becomes a problem for that kind of music. For the most part, of course, there will be a few exceptions, but I think if you
melancholy,
I don't know. Is it like a triple LP? What is it, Thomas?
No, I don't think. Is it triple?
Well, I can't remember.
Well, you have it in your lap, though.
We will look it up.
Yeah.
We will look it up.
But music was the word, Stunty. You have music for us?
Restless eyes close, maybe it'll go away. Please rest tomorrow, bring a satisfied day. The restless urge above that's worth the burden.
Very simple bass line, always.
Surely it's that one comfort, love to give you more.
So, the gallery likes your choice. Yeah, but somehow it faded out. That's pity. There's more.
So this is Sebado, who is Lou Barlow's band, the bass player from Dinosaur Jr. And when he had enough of all the silliness of Jay Mathis, the leader of his band, he started this band. And there's quite a bunch of albums that are absolutely amazing, that have really catchy melodies, like a voice that is very beautiful as well, a lo-fi quality, but also with the noise, you know, this quiet, loud. I saw them like 4 or 5 times back then. It's
Thomas, have you been aware of Sebado?
No.
Me neither, by the way. We've learned something and sound like worth getting into it. Thank you very much, son.
But I found out that it's a triple album.
Yeah.
We saw that in the gallery too. Thank you so much.
And the first issue is numbered.
Yes.
They did quite a few of these then.
Yeah, but try to get one nowadays. Yeah. I try desperately for at least 1.5 years now to find a decent copy. Yeah. Okay. Thomas.
They became quite popular with a record called Pharmacy. For me, it's all about these five first. Maybe this one as well that is the sixth one. But after that, it becomes a bit too polished for me, which is why, in my opinion, why also grunge kind of disappeared. Because, of course, when you do that for like 4, 5, 6 years, it's difficult to help yourself but trying to be more professional. And so it goes kind of against the whole ethos okay. of the music.
Stati, now that you just mentioned, it became more and more polished. Let's get into a time frame. Where are the roots? When did it start? When was it at its heights? When did it end?
For me, it starts with bands like Husker Du, the Swans, and the Big Black.
How about Velvet Underground?
Of course, you could, like Nirvana did a cover of the Velvet Underground on the tribute album, if I remember correctly. And it's actually the best cover in the whole compilation. You could say so in the sense of being highly melodic, but then you would say also Marky Moon. I think we have a moratorium. Maybe.
Exactly, more of the Pixies, right?
Yeah, for me, I guess that would be one take that is a little bit controversial, but because the Pixies are their own thing, but the Pixies kind of paved the way. I would say first you have the Twins, the Husker Du, and Big Black, and right after you'd have like Sonic Youth and the Pixies. Yeah.
Yeah, Justin also says so. Yeah. And again, and I totally agree, because this is almost common knowledge. Neil Young is always called the grandfather of grunge.
By one side of grunge, namely stuff like Pearl Jam, which I think is not grunge.
Okay. Pearl Jam is not grunge. Okay, then he is not the grandfather. Okay. Many people consider.
Yeah, but that's something that was kind of an after construction. That's a lot because of the movie Dead Man, which had a soundtrack, which kind of like bridged together all of that. But I think it's an after the fact construction a little bit. There's some logic. It's not stupid to say that at all. I wouldn't dare say that. But back then. If you meet kids who are 14, 15, who listen to that music and Neil Young, statistically, of course, you'll find some, but it's kind of too remote, in my opinion.
But there seems to be, at least from the general idea and the habits, a strong connection to punk, right?
Punk, well, yeah, there like... For me, punk is something very English, and that's why we say punk rock when we talk about the American bands, because rock is very American. Mm-hmm. And I mean, for the most part, especially in the 90s, like there was an aesthetic quality to a guitar riff from the American band that you could instantly recognize, and same with an English band or a UK band. And I remember in the shops, like the real indie shops, you wouldn't have like a section that was called grunge. It would be called punk rock or American punk rock, because grunge was like for, you know, the magazines in a way. But because it is rooted in rock, obviously, of course, you can bridge it with Neil Young. And before the stream, we were kind of talking about like the cinematographic aspect of the American culture, movies like Paris, Texas by Wim Wenders, a German, but still that kind of captures the alienation of outcasts in the 80s, but not necessarily in a rebellious way, like in the late 70s, early 80s, but kind of in a almost like autistic relation with society, which is kind of... what was pretty common in the whole grunge sphere, scene, etc.
Thomas, I imagine you don't have prepared Neil Young now for us. You probably have prepared something else.
I do have Neil Young.
I can imagine that you have quite some Neil Young, but probably not for today.
Not for today. So for me, the grunge started in 91, where I think most of it ended.
Okay.
Because I come from a farmer side of Denmark where nobody played that kind of music at that time. So I started from the end and moving backwards to learning. Mm-hmm. But one of the bands that I really liked, I heard it in the radio a week ago, and I'm not sure if you'll call it grunge, but I'll try to play it here and see what you say.
No, it's more rock, no. Right?
More rock, yeah.
This is like proto neo metal, in my opinion.
Uh-huh. Can you show the record for me? So Christopher calls this one a masterpiece. He probably knows it. And this is 1991?
Oh, it's later.
Oh, it's later, it's okay. Yeah, like late 90s, yeah. Yeah. 2001, okay.
It's one of those songs that sounds amazing in the car, because it's...
I can imagine, yeah. But you always get a ticket for speeding when you listen to this while driving, right?
Yeah, you do.
Yeah, like the singing is for me, the opposite of grunge, the antithesis, like yeah. Affection and... not to say anything about the music itself, apart from no, Thomas, this is not grunge. But if you want to bridge it, if we really want to bridge it with Neil Young, there are. Now that I think about it, there are a few examples. Yeah, I would say grunge is like between 85 and 93. After 93, it's something else.
So grunge, from the beginning, has been in genre where you really dig into something?
Where I really what?
Where you really digged into it and got deep into it and were very interested and love it until today?
Yeah, probably, yeah, that's my my youth, yeah, absolutely. But this is not a band that many people talk about. It's a band that had a female singer, but they were not flashy like L7, Babes in Toyland, and all these bands, and you see the music is more... kind of, there's no hook. It's more like the traditional, like Neil Young type of music in a way. and it's kind of a classic in the making. I think they reissued it a few years ago, but back then, when you were into that kind of music, that was like, you knew about it.
What year are we talking, Stanti? I don't know, remember if it was
92.
Okay. You never know, Justin. Butterfly effect.
Warm work with them.
You know, Thomas, when we talk about grunge and the bands that are connected to it, I think it's safe to say that those bands and those records, when you have originals, they really sell fast and they really sell good, and the prices went up and up and up, right? When it comes to those originals. Or correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, I think like 5-6 years ago, you paid like 50 for a Pearl Jam. Now they are like 300-400.
Wow.
So they go up in price and it gets more and more difficult to find them in good condition.
So for what band does this go? I can imagine Pearl Jam, Nirvana for sure. I mean, they are sometimes...
Soundgarden, Temple of the Dog, yeah, Alice in Chains.
Yeah.
And I saw somebody said Stone Temple Pilots also.
Nice.
Also a good expensive.
But Stone Temple Pilots, they're pretty good, but they were kind of like more of an alternative rock band that just happened during grunge, so they had some connection with it. But they were more rock stars than, like, they had, like, it was a little bit different. It's not, I would say, like, they're not completely outside of it, but they're really in the periphery.
Yeah, Stanti, you know, look, that's what we all do, and that's what happens all the time. Look at krautrock. I mean, if you are in Germany at a certain period of time, you are krautrock. You can do whatever you want, it's krautrock.
Yeah, and they were in Seattle, so...
So, yeah, exactly.
No, not Stone Temple Pilots. Sorry, I'm thinking of Soundgarden now.
So this is typical for the time. I mean, that there is some grunge that isn't just because it's in the vicinity or the time period, that makes sense.
Yeah, I think that a lot of great grunge records are 7-inches because a lot of people who did that music were inspired by the you know, the kind of lo-fi, like, we don't need to be stars to do it or to look good or etc. So there was not it was, you know, something you could do when you were a teenager without necessarily having dreams of becoming big. Some did, but there was kind of a glass ceiling to a certain degree. Just the fact that a band like Dinosaur Jr. now is a legacy band is incredible. Like, normally it should never be like that because there's nothing in the music that goes in that direction. With a band like Stone Temple Pilots or Alice in Chains, of course there is that. There is the potential of becoming like MTV bands. But that also means that because of grunge, MTV had to change a little bit. And we talked a little bit about that with our hip-hop stream, because there's an artist that is close to grunge, that is kind of grunge in many regards. And
Beck.
Beck.
Yeah.
If you talk about Neil Young as well, in the early stuff, Beck was doing like really lo-fi folk, with some like pedals, like noise and stuff like that, with some singing, pop singing mm-hmm. over it. That's grunge. That's his first vinyl, released vinyl. It's an EP from 91, I believe.
Okay.
It's really, really good.
It's a 10-inch or what is it?
It's a 10-inch, yeah, yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, Christopher, Queensryche is definitely from Seattle and definitely not grunge, indeed. Yeah.
Thomas showed a record too. Is it back to what you showed us? Yeah, yeah. Mellow Gold. Yeah, Beck, amazing artist, but not consistently grungy, right?
No, there's only up until 94.
Yeah.
Now, he has grunge adjacent music and in yeah. his culture, but this one is when he's not grunge anymore.
Yeah.
In my opinion. This one is kind of still, yeah. This one is amazing. Yeah. And this one is his best one by far. And this one is totally, this came out on K Records, which is a label that is very important for grunge or this kind of rock because of, let me play something. That is not on K Records, but still. Oh.
Yeah. Yeah, but when you go through them, quite some legendary records. You have to give him that, huh? Modern Guilt.
Ready for something?
I think Thomas is. Yeah.
Yeah, I have something. Let's see.
You have or I have? Sorry.
let Thomas show his records and okay, then we put up.
I think it's good. It's just all the Beck albums.
Of course it's all. Okay. I don't know that one.
12-inch. But I collected the 7-inch as well. I have all the 7-inch and 10-inch.
Okay.
Just and this is the loser.
Yeah.
12-inch, but it came as a promo first. I have somewhere like one.
Yeah, and not on DJ, David Geffen Group originally. It was released on basically he signed on DGC, the same label as Nirvana, but they made a deal on that the label he was very cool indie label would actually get credit for that on the single.
Damn, what an output. I wasn't aware that he had put out that many records.
Well, wow. He's a Scientologist, so he has to work for them.
Yeah.
Scientologist.
I think he did like 13, 14 albums, something like
okay.
that.
Okay. Stanti, you have prepared something for us.
Yeah, that is like not exactly directly grunge, but also very much exists on because of that and from that scene.
That's rough.
The leader of that band, Kathleen Hannon, she was Kurt Cobain's girlfriend before Courtney Love. And because she was a girl, a woman, they decided to label that as Riot Girl instead of grunge.
Okay.
And it was kind of also one of these labels that the press comes up. This is interesting record because it's a split mini album between Dick Mikkel and Huggy Bear. Huggy Bear is from the UK, but we're doing the same thing, which means also grunge is not something that is necessarily local. It's really the spirit of the time. And when you look at the artwork on this, this is when you see that, you know it's a grunge record. Like the aesthetic, okay, like bad pictures, handwritten, like in a kind of very basic. A picture of artwork put on the table, something very do-it-yourself.
Yes.
You know it's going to be that.
Okay, Thomas.
And she went on to do a very popular band that was a bit more pop, called I forget the name, but and that's true. Catherine went on to marry the guy from the Beastie Boys.
Okay, I wasn't aware of that.
But very short songs.
Those, yeah, but that's not so typical for grunge. Those short songs, right? That was not a criteria, or was it?
No, it was all more like the Riot Girl side of grunge. Yeah, for sure. And yeah, it's like I have tons of 7 inches of them. There's also, like, as we kind of hinted, a lot of that music was 7-inch.
Peel, okay, they also did a Peel session.
Oh, yeah, yeah. John Peel was heavy, heavy into supporting grunge and this scene.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Most grunge bands proper, like Unsane, had like 3 or 4 Peel sessions. Sebado, many, like all these bands, like they definitely, if they came to the UK, John Peel would have them.
So, but what's not so totally clear for me? You mentioned it briefly, but is grunge an American thing?
Yes, not? Yes. And Huggy Bear is an English band, but they are kind of... I picked up a bass when I was that age because of I was listening to this music, and then I went on to do something different, but that also had something to do with it because that's what influenced me to start. So, but yeah, I would say that it's mostly an American thing, obviously. Yeah.
Yeah. No big. What are the most well-known European grunge bands, if there are any? Name some, if possible.
Well, they wouldn't call themselves grunge then, but. Difficult to say. Man. Yeah.
No, if not, then there is nothing, then no problem. It was just you know, I'm a bit slow tonight because I'm really fighting against my fever and I'm sitting here soaking wet. So.
Well, I would say maybe I play that. Unless Thomas has... This band, this album from this band is for me quite
modern talking, yeah.
Yeah. It has some metal in it.
Yeah.
But it is like it wouldn't sound like that without grunge.
Groovy Bone says Radiohead. I
bass sound very grunge, vocals very grunge, guitar less so. This is an amazing album, by the way.
Yeah. again, a grunge band I wasn't aware of. Thanks for sharing those.
So technically, they are considered a grindcore band,
mm-hmm.
but with this album, it is obviously it's much different than anything else they've done. But if you listen to this and think of Nirvana, mm-hmm. This is so close to it. It's much closer than, I would say, Pearl Jam or Soundgarden.
Thomas, what have you done in the corner? Did you pick up something?
Yeah, it's. I saw somebody talked about a Danish band called Psycho Danish, which was a Danish grunge band, the closest we get to it. And I just saw it the other day, so I was just trying to find it.
Did you?
No. I found the disc copy of it.
Okay.
But it's a sealed copy. I can't play it. But this is okay. Danish grunge, if you could say so.
Okay. From what year is it?
It's it doesn't say any year on this one, so I can't remember. I think it's from 1994.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Danish grunge. Stunt, see?
Yeah, and there's actually a German band it's a grunge band called 18th Die that were pretty good. I think they had one album produced by Steve Albini. And of course, if we talk about like influences, like grandfathers of all that, there's a case to be made that DX from the Netherlands are important for that kind of music. Just so, for people who don't know, Fudge Tunnel is Alex Newport, who went on to do Nailbomb with Max Cavalera from Sepultura, which is very different from Sepultura. But this is kind of where you kind of get close to metal in a way, but where the aesthetic of it is so different. Because grindcore is different.
Thomas, have you prepared a song, a little music for us too?
I have a little music. I think in my head was influenced by grunge. Let's hear it. Indie collection. So I'm not totally sure, but I love those
indie collections. Yeah, that's amazing. Great. Yeah, I agree. And Thomas, one question: you as a DJ, how do you get grunge music into your sets, if you do at all? Do you?
Yeah. if you're a grunge DJ, you just come and play it. But I normally, when people had got a few beers, the time is after 2 in the night, and you put on the grunge set, everybody explodes. It's really powerful.
It's a question. It's a question of timing.
It's a question of timing. Yeah. Everybody likes it at after 2 o'clock.
Okay, after 2 o'clock. Okay.
After Stanzi, 2 o'clock and after too much disco, they're ready.
Stanti, what is your time for putting up some grunge when you do when you DJ?
Man, that's the tough one. Like, I mean, because it's a generational thing. I expect this to be a generational thing. Like, I don't understand why anyone who's under 35 would be interested in that in a way, because there's some great music in it, but it's also, I mean, it is generational. It's
every genre is generational, isn't it?
There is, you know, I often talk about this abstract idea of timelessness in music. There's very little grunge that I find timeless. I can always say, oh, this is from 92, 91, 90. Like, for example, next song I have lined up, it's because of certain aspects, it's easy to figure out when it's from. But you get a very grungy bass line, which is why it is grunge. Mm-hmm.
Why does your music get so silent after 5 seconds? It starts loud and then it goes down after 5 seconds. Colored vinyl. What do you want to say, Stanti?
You can't really hear it too much, apart from a few times, but what's unusual for this band back then is they use the sampler on stage. There's one guy who is on keyboard, which is an instrument that is almost absent of all grunge. Which means that bands like Cop Shoot Cop, which are more noise bands, but that were part of that wave as well, or not directly grunge, but this was on Touch and Go, which is for me is Sub Pop, probably the biggest grunge label.
Okay.
They went on to have like a bigger success, like around 94, 95, when it was kind of over already.
Okay.
Thomas?
Yes?
You have something?
I think he's at it. He's right at it, Stati.
Parfait.
I have a problem with the hit.
And his music then says, grunge is a strange term of a genre, and it just gets weirder every year. Bands that definitely were considered grunge in the early 90s are now considered grunge. I think he meant in the 90s, they are not considered grunge. They are now considered grunge.
Yeah, I think totally agree.
Yeah. That's true. That's totally true.
One thing we have not necessarily talked about directly is how, let me see, how a lot of these bands thankfully introduced you to a world beyond that. Like the biggest band was obviously Nirvana, so Kurt Cobain, and Kurt Cobain did that record with William Burroughs.
Okay.
So it's just Kurt Cobain, like, improvising on guitar over a text read by William Burroughs, the beatnik poet, who is also one of the biggest influences of Throbbing Gristle, Cabaret Voltaire. And that record was, it's not something that you would play on the radio, but yeah, it's got an etching of both there. Yeah.
he did that pre Nirvana or during that time?
Oh, during he died.
It was a side project, and he already did Nirvana.
Basically, the label were working with William Burroughs. It's Tim Kerr, who was a sound engineer and musician, and but you see Portland. So basically, Kurt Cobain did that as a favor to him because he was the biggest star in the world. So he knew that him putting his name on that would give this exposure. So that's it's quite interesting because it's one of these cynical projects, you know, when a star puts his name on something to sell it. But in this case, it is to sell the most avant-garde experimental stuff with William Burroughs. Just crazy.
That's cool. That's cool. I think, what is Thomas there or is he gone? Ah, there is Thomas. He was okay. Whatever he did. Can we come back to you?
Yeah, the thing I'm playing now is after grunge as well, but a big influence, of course. In the sound, it's not much grunge, but in the blood, it's a lot of grunge. And I think their first album came in 1995.
Wonderful album. I really am loving this one, and I can imagine that Stanti now says, oh, that's not good.
No, the sound is not good.
It's alternative rock,
But are they considered to be grunge in certain?
No, they are considered to be. No, I can't say it.
Careful, my friend.
Yeah. I was more thinking about something that comes out of your nether regions, but
let's agree on the nether regions of Stanti.
But if we talk about that, then like Thomas, what do you like when we were talking about like the most pricey grunge records? Would you agree that this one is the most pricey grunge records of them all?
Yeah, yeah, I think it is.
1,000 copies only.
Yeah.
Okay.
I bought this $1.
You bought this for $1, and it was in the dollar bin, so to say.
No, it was in at the Rough Trade shop in 1991, and they had got some back stock of it or something, and there it is.
Wow. So it's
the first. It's the first Nirvana on Sub Pop.
Nice. You have that one too, Thomas?
No, I don't have that one. I've never seen it.
Never seen it? Okay. No. So lucky you, Stanti. You have a spare copy?
Well, look, I was there at the time. What can I say? It's I hear that some people are paying like $5,000 for it.
I can imagine.
I don't know if it's true, but yeah.
And I don't ask you now because you probably get a copy for €40. But the Nirvana, never mind the first pressing, the right one, the US one. Okay, if you have it, it might be more expensive. What do you think, Thomas, for a very good copy? What do you have to pay for it, roughly? What do you think?
I think it's 1,500, 2,000 for a Nirvana copy. And the prices for that one just go up and up. 10 years ago, it was 100 for original.
100? Okay. Yeah.
And what about an original European pressing of it?
From 100.
Okay. Yeah. So that big of a difference.
Yeah,
I think if I had an AMN copy, it might be 200, but that's a huge difference between.
There's a huge difference, and in that case, that's one of the good clues we can give, because the European pressing of that sounds, comparatively to the US pressing, really, really, really good.
So it's, you would say the European sounds better than the US?
It doesn't sound worse, for sure. And I've compared it extensively. Okay. That's one record I bought that record on release day, European version, obviously, because and I remember I was telling my mates at school that this afternoon I'm going to skip school because I have to go buy the Nirvana record, and they were like, who? You're going to know about
you that. Know what, okay.
And I still, like, I have vivid memories of, like, I mean, you get, like, I don't know if you guys have that, like a record that was so instrumental for you in your youth that you kind of remember, have you got it and have you talked about it? And for me, yeah, it's this one for sure, 100%. It's, I will never need to listen to it again, but I will gladly do it every now and then.
So, Hey Joe says 10 is a better debut than Nevermind. Oh.
Well, Nevermind is not a debut. And
okay.
And, Hey Joe is welcome to his opinion.
Of course he is. Bleach is Vinyl Pipers. Here we have
Bleach, I think, is it's an interesting album, but I would say it... like Nevermind has way more, is covering way more ground. Yeah. And that's another one that I bought on release day. And of course, it had this stupid thing on the cover. Which made it sound a bit strange, but.
Stanti, or maybe Thomas. Grunge, where does this term come from? Is it again a term that was created by the music journalists, or why grunge?
I'll let Thomas say it if he knows, because I'm too polite.
I heard that they made a rule when what grunge was, and there was like you can only play like five different ways to play the guitar, and you can only use three of them in one song. That was like a rule they had in that time.
Okay.
I don't know if that's the truth.
Well, you know what grunge is, Thomas? Technically, before it's a music style?
No.
It's toe jam. It's the dirt you have between your toes on your feet when it gets too humid.
I never had that, so I didn't know. But who came up with the term?
Well, it's the press. It was to explain that these guys, compared to hard rock, heavy metal, they were like dirty. They were like, you know, drug addicts, homeless, which a lot of them were in Seattle. Like, basically, when these guys started to get interviewed and they told the story of their life, some journalists took that from that.
Yeah. And when this really became quite popular, and you said it, Nirvana at a certain point was the most important and most successful band of the world for a short period of time.
I think they still are.
I know what you're talking about. Yeah, in a way, I agree. But has there also been, like, when it comes to punk, it was so vain, so much fashion, so much style. Did grunge get into this trap too? Or did they manage to avoid this in a way?
I think it's...
I mean, Kurt Cobain did by killing himself, but...
If you talk about fashion and all that, I think it's the right time for Thomas to show us a record, the soundtrack of a certain movie.
Yeah, exactly. We have at the OBC shop, we have a grunge soundtrack. And you're right. This is a perfect time for this because that's quite funny, right? And it, in a way, it answers the question, right? Mm. Singles, yeah. And I think on that soundtrack, there is a song from, is it Pearl Jam? That is only on the soundtrack, right? Yeah, exactly, Christopher. Yeah, singles. Yeah.
But it also has...
Yeah, go.
It has a lot of famous names. Like you also see Smashing Pumpkins there, Mudhoney, Alice in Chains, Chris Cornell. There's a lot of big names on this album, which some of the tracks you can only find like this.
So that means it became mainstream. It got occupied by the industry. It became commercial. Can I paint it that black, or am I right here, or am I wrong, Stanti?
It depends how you. I would say yes, but. Then some people would be offended when I say, yeah, it became commercial when bands like Pearl Jam and Soundgarden started to have like a stadium sound, which you might like. It is perfectly fine. Mm-hmm. But if you think of grunge initially and you associate that with stadium, then you've missed it. I think most people would agree with that. But when you hear, what's the name of that on Pearl Jam? Like... Their biggest song with the first name of a kid. The song is sorry.
I'll say "Alive" is the biggest song.
No, it's the like not Tommy, but it's a word like that. It's like a first name. Where basically you have Jeremiah. Yeah. So Jeremiah, when you hear it, you can totally picture that in a stadium.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's got this like really big sound and like performative aspect of the music, which is, in my opinion, when if you go that way, then you're like kind of waving bye-bye.
Yeah, but Santi, I think what you consider and rightfully so, this stadium sound, the roots are it. Are already at the beginning, in my opinion. I mean, this catchy rhythms, those melodies, they are catchy. They are gigantic. I mean, Smells Like Teen Spirit is fit for playing in the stadium.
Not really. I disagree with you on that. Like when you listen to the sound and the production and all that, no, it's meant to be played in a club, but not in a stadium. It like...
I think it would work very, very good.
And when you listen to Bleach, nothing there is for Stadium, like not a single song.
Yeah.
And but cool. Even like Smells Like Teen Spirit, like you know, just think about the production, the sound of the voice on the record. It's really for the club, like low ceiling and like. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
is there something, you know, when we have the lines, the connections to punk, we have this famous and overused term of post-punk. Mm-hmm. Is there something like post-grunge?
Funny you would say that. I didn't prepare it, but there is currently a few bands that I find absolutely wonderful. Dubstep bands that mm-hmm. use bass lines and guitar riffs that sound like, you know, this kind of fretless bass, grungy, and it's wonderful. And of course, like, there's no way it's not coming from that. Mm-hmm. There are also bands like I think this is a pretty good post grunge band, Part Chimp.
Okay.
That has this kind of, like, if you're saying post-punk, that could be a post-grunge. But even better, this guy, he's on Sub Pop, so Vaughn Gibson.
Yeah.
He's a crooner, and he's on Sub Pop, and he's definitely coming from grunge. The music is not necessarily grunge, but there's something about it that it's completely right that this is on Sub Pop.
When you just said when I mentioned Nirvana as the most influential band, and you say it's until now, which I kind of agree. Has there
the Beatles been and Nirvana? Yeah.
Has there been a revival? Yeah.
Of Nirvana?
No, of grunge.
Well, I think because of the nature of it. If you wanted to do grunge the same way as back then, people would laugh at you, or it would be for kids. So if there is to be a revival, you have to insert that in something different. Like mm-hmm. this thing in dubstep that I've identified a few bands doing that. It's like, even talking about it, I get excited a little bit because it's so clever. But there is a bit of nostalgia, which I think is a bit of, like, you can't escape that. But it's also looking into the future. And I mean, there will always be bands, like, if you think about it, when you're talking about the ethos of, like, not big rock stars and all that, then you could argue that MC5 were kind of also original grunge in the sense that they looked normal. They didn't have costumes and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as, you know, like these bands, like, from the early mid 90s, like Green Day,
mm-hmm.
that, like, no one who was into grunge in 90 would even, like, you would feel dirty listening to that a little bit. But I could see this kind of bands existing again.
Okay. Thomas, have you prepared something for us?
I just took a little bit from this album.
Ah, from the single soundtrack. Nice.
Yeah.
Let's see if this food survives. For those who are not so familiar with grunge and want to get a bit into it, this might be a good entry point, as you have quite some bands on that soundtrack. Are there grunge samplers we can recommend? Are there any? You know, sampler. Some or sampler or Stunty, you know, no good grunge samplers for people who want to get a little bit deeper into it and get an idea. Because I think sometimes samplers are a very, very good way of getting into things.
The German distributor label City Slanged, I know they did quite a few samplers in the early 90s, and they were pretty good. I don't have any because they were literally samplers of records I have. I bought the record, so I don't need it. But other than that, Harris Pilton is pretty correct there. But the label from Austin, Texas, called Trans Syndicate, had a few compilations with original tracks that are pretty good called Love and Napalm. But it's also the not the big names. Yeah, I'm not too familiar with any compilations of...
Yeah, of course. No, it was maybe you give us a little more music. Now we talked long enough so that I'm very careful with this kind of music. So.
This is the Pearl Jam track from singles.
Which probably gets the stream off of YouTube.
Yeah.
We will see. We will see. There is a grunge documentary hype. Okay. Thank you.
Well,
can we see that on YouTube?
I think some of the best documentaries about grunge are like not necessarily documentaries historical, but there was a tour documentary called 1991, the year punk broke, I believe, which was following Sonic Youth with different bands that opened for them, including Nirvana. And I haven't seen it since back then, but I remember that kind of showed you well what punk was, what grunge was. And then there are a few more underground movies, like there's this movie called Hippie Porn by this guy from Los Angeles that is really good grunge movie, like the life of people who lived that, featuring like original soundtrack with Unsane, Cop Shoot Cop and stuff like that. Then there are the movies of Richard Kern, which are short movies, but you can find compilations which feature Lydia Lunch and the guy from Fetus, Nick Roon. But these movies, I mean, if you know, do you know, Michael, this movie called American Splendor, which is a comic book movie? It's about a cartoonist called Harvey Pecker.
I think, but don't
you
ask
probably
me
know it.
Tonight. Don't ask me. Think that longer ago
Fair
than
enough.
One.
But that movie.
I have to finish the stream in let's say 5 to 10 minutes because I really need to go to bed. I am not up for 2 hours today, so don't be angry with me tonight, because the fever is at a new height, I think.
As I was hinting to it to Thomas earlier, like, let's hear some sitar grunge. Which also bridges then your first comment about the Velvet Underground.
Yeah.
Bojo, I think we're talking about this.
But why do you consider this grunge, Stunty, due to the connection to the Velvet Underground, because the bass line is?
Well, the track develops more in movement. It's true what you say. Like, this track is a little bit different from the rest of the album. But it is very much a painting song. It's just, again, to show that grunge was not just a self-contained thing. Like when I was showing this record with Kurt Cobain and William Burroughs, also when you're a kid and you listen to this because it's a noise grunge band, of course that opens you up to stuff that is again like this kind of outside thinking, outside mentality. Like sitar.
Yeah.
Okay, the Beatles had it in the 60s, but who had a sitar in the 90s? What kind of rock bands we have? There would need to be music that is kind of a bit quirky, which I think.
Stunty, when you have both running the music and talking, it's very difficult to understand. That's for sure. It's the sitar. He always does, Christopher. Stunty always does.
It's their last. This is their last album, so there are some exceptions to the rules.
That's why it's a rule, right? There are always exceptions. Thomas, have you prepared? Have you prepared a last song for us, or anything you want to add to what we forgot so far?
No, I think it's just amazing to hear Stunty with those tracks.
Like always, right? This guy.
Good things.
We don't like him, but his knowledge of music is amazing.
When you go into deep, it's always really, really interesting. And I think like with grunge, it's been many years since I listened to it the last time, but it's he make it interesting again.
Yes. Let me show you quickly
a bunch of covers of, like, this is the Breeders before they went really pop, but when they were really noisy, which I think is connected. Like this band is a really cool, like lo-fi grunge band, Red Meat, that became a more interesting band called Caliphone later. Also, you have Shipping News, which is, you could say, post-grunge, because the people there are coming from bands that were the grunge bands, but like post-punk back then, whiz punk. Smug, also not there directly grunge, but coming from the same aesthetics, the same instrumentation, but more lo-fi. Of course, like Thomas has this in the shop, which I think is like one of the greatest Sonic Youth records, but there are so many that are the grunge stuff, because not everything they did is, in my opinion, grunge. But yeah, we're thinking about the Swans, band that that started in more in the like post-hardcore scene from Washington, I think. And that were more indie rock in a way, but that are still like very important for me in the grunge paradigm, because they are really like, they would be the Beatles of grunge in a way, and that's Unrest. This album, Imperial FFRR, is, the songs are typical like grunge themes, and it's just great. And like, we always talk about grandfather, like the grandmother of grunge in many ways. A great British, like psychedelic noise grunge band that I talked about, Mint 400, three EPs that are amazing. Of course, my dear Jesus Lizard, which I, most of the records I have signed by everyone.
Nice.
As a kid.
Stunted GPT, yeah, exactly.
And they had these horrible...
5.0, yeah.
Oh, yeah. This is the hype stickers of the 90s, by the way. Pretty basic, yeah.
Colored vinyl, yeah. That's true.
Oh,
and today, we say, oh, be careful.
Yeah. This is a grunge band that... for me, or their sound, like, what if Husker Du were really a band from the early 90s? And they have like 3-4 albums that are really fantastic. AC Temple, also like noise grunge stuff that is gonna go up in price eventually, but you can still find for like $5. Or bands like this that everyone forgot, like one of these typical grunge bands that only had like one, maybe two albums.
Okay, one question. Do we also have those notorious private presses when it comes to grunge music, Stunty?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. But let me see if I have something here. Well, you'd have it in the 7 inches. Well, or private press, like, depends what you mean. Like, if it's like a one-off, but like, for example, this was on, I don't know how many releases there are on that labels, mm-hmm. But there can't be that many. Sick of Music, this table. This is on the Homestead Records. This is a good label, but this, I have nothing else of them. Dreams Made Flesh.
Crazy.
I have like dozens and dozens of stuff like that.
Nice.
But there is, when you talk about revival, like this band that I love, Jesus Lizard, for Record Store Day a few years ago, they
okay. did this. Yeah, I remember that. Yeah. One of the very few Record Store Day releases Stunty has, probably.
Yeah,
plus of course, the Cure picture disc, right?
Of course. Here you have Don Fleming, very important figure for grunge as well, doing a cover of Telstar with Thurston Moore, which is cool because on the B-side you have...
It's beautiful. Nice.
Yeah, and you have Experimental Audio Research, which is Sonic Boom from Spaceman 3 with Kevin Shields from My Bloody Valentine, amongst other people.
So in a way, Thomas, Stunty did a little bit your job you usually do, right? Having them all, great. And it's amazing, right? So grunge. You are interested in it, but you're not so deep into it. And so Stunty did a fantastic job today to fill, that's not correct, the correct term, but in lack for better words, he filled some gaps. Very, very great
job.
And
you know, there's so much, now that I think about it, because like we were like while doing it, I realized a few things. There are tons of bands like this, Pond, which were signed on Sub Pop. It's really good, like more song-based, melodic grunge. They have a couple of albums. Yeah, it's on Sub Pop. And it's good. It's not like the greatest thing ever. But if you're into that kind of music, then it's actually really good. And it's not the big name. So you can still find it for like very... reasonable prices for around $10 probably.
Cool. That's cool. Okay, guys, as I said, I am not up for 2 hours today. Please excuse me. Next week I will be again, hopefully. And yeah. You have some last song for us or some things you want to add? If it's a song, play a song. If you want to say something, doing so now?
I have a song, but it's, I think it's also inspired from the grunge, but it's a band we haven't talked about.
Pavement.
Yeah, and that's my favorite album of them, so please, by all means. This is, for me, this is one of the 10 best records of the 90s. It's the first band I, you know, as a fan, I followed them on tour. I was on their tour bus for 3 dates, and the music is genius. It's so, this is like, for me, the best of the 90s in rock music. This album is, along with the Last Splash by the Breeders, both albums that are heavily indebted to grunge. I think that the fact that they could do these albums and be successful with these is because of the success of grunge, definitely. And the Breeders were one of Kurt Cobain's favorite bands, and everything about Pavement is grunge, in my opinion.
So, thank you all very, very much for joining us tonight. That was our take on grunge. And we will see us next week, same time, probably again for 2 hours, with another amazing topic. Santi will hopefully join us again. Santi, you want to say something?
Yeah, because with this we can bridge to you with your favorite music, Michael. Look at this cover.
Let me go to bed.
No, but just okay. Because no, this is such a good opportunity. What does that remind you, Michael, in terms of artwork?
Star Wars.
Guru Guru.
Guru Guru, yeah, you're right. You're right.
It's,
you're right.
This is an homage to Guru Guru.
You will see tons. You will see tons of grunge records. There are already some at the OBC. But within the next days, you will see tons of grunge records. I don't know if 10 is among the tons.
Happy.
It might be. Okay, guys. See you.